All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to my session about Kubernetes. Well, my name is Pascal Naber. I'm from the Netherlands. I work for Xperit, and Xperit, we do Xperit shit. That's also where I did where it is t-shirt. I have also some laptop stickers. If you like, after the session, grab a sticker if you like. I have also some t-shirts to give away in the different sizes. Please tweet a picture of me and my slides, and I have hidden some Do Epic Shit logos in the slides. If you tweet them or put them on other social media, let me know, and then I will contact you during the conference, and you can grab your t-shirt. All right, let's begin. This session is about Kubernetes, and I would like to have a show of hands, please. Who doesn't have any experience with Docker? Who doesn't have any experience? So quite a few of you. And who have actually played or is using Kubernetes? Who does that? Some hands, okay. Well, for the people who doesn't have any experience with Docker, this is not an introduction into Docker. We are going to talk about Kubernetes, and Kubernetes is running Docker images, so I have to mention Docker, but we won't go into detail. Because if you're using Docker images and you see the power of it, that you can run them on your own local machine, that you don't have to install any dependencies, and you see that power and you're running them on your server, and you want to move to production, then you will have some challenges about scaling, load balancing, and fault tolerance. Let's see a simple example. You can run your Docker images on a local machine, on a virtual machine, in the cloud maybe. Then you have to configure some load balancers. And this is my application with some front-end Docker images and back-end images that I run on for my local for my application that I have as a demo. And I hit the limits of this machine. So actually, I want to scale out. And this is hard, because now I have to manage even more than the load balancers and the virtual machine that I already had. Actually, what I would like is that the other servers are running containers also. And also these servers are running load balancers. And I have to manage it all. So this is where the container orchestrator comes in. He is managing the whole cluster of machines for me. Besides this, if this server goes down, then the container orchestrator arranges that container images are running on the other machines. So that's very convenient. This is not specific to Kubernetes. Every container orchestrator can do this for you. There are several here at the bottom. And not only this functionality, also health monitoring, load balancing, they are self-healing, rolling updates without downtime, they can do it all. So let's have a look from a high perspective what these container orchestrators, how they look like. Well, actually all more or less the same. They have a cluster of machines, so multiple virtual machines, and they consist of a master and several worker nodes. The worker nodes are doing the work, so they are running the Docker images for you. The master is managing the cluster. For Kubernetes, this is no difference. It looks exactly the same. Sometimes you read a book or an old article, and they mention minions. Then they are talking about the nodes. It's the old term in the Kubernetes terminology. So one level deeper. We can see the master and the worker node here again. And you can see that there are several components. On the worker, you can see that there are Docker images, but they don't run directly on the worker node. They run in pods. I will mention pods later on in the presentation. And then we have the master. There are some important components there, like etcd, the key value store, open source. Kubernetes is using there to store all its state. And another important component that we will be using during the session, the API server. The API server is your access point to manage the cluster. It's a REST-based server, so you can call the API server with the REST client, but you can also use the command line interface, kubectl. Some name it kubectl. For the people who like more a visual representation, there is also a dashboard, a web application. We will see both the CLI and the dashboard during this session. Well, where is Kubernetes coming from? A bit of history. It all started at Google only a couple of years ago. And Google is using container technology for over a decade. They have their own internal container orchestrator called Borg. And Borg is named after the Star Trek character. A group of people started with a new container orchestrator. And they called it 7 of 9, also after a Star Trek character. It's the friendlier Borg. In 2015, Kubernetes was going live with version 1. And Google gave it to the open source community. Together with the Linux Foundation, they created the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, CNCF. Kubernetes was the first project of CNCF, and now there are like 30 projects in it. And they have several stages for each project. This year, Kubernetes reached the highest level, the graduate level, and that means that there are a lot of contributors, a lot of users and enterprises using Kubernetes, so you can really trust it and build on it. It is a major project now. In the meantime, there is another project in the graduate state now, Prometheus. Nice to know, by the way, that the 7 spokes in the logo of Kubernetes are a nod to the code name 7 of 9. So, Kubernetes. Many times you see the abbreviation K8S, and the 8 is standing for the number of characters between the K and the S. It's an open source framework. It's written in Golang. You can find it on GitHub. It's one of the most active projects on GitHub. And it is known for extensibility. Every component that we have already talked about and where I will talk about is extensible. And that is a very big advantage because many companies and open source communities are building tools in and on Kubernetes. It's an enormous ecosystem, and that within 3 years. It's only growing. Another advantage of Kubernetes is that you can configure Kubernetes with declarative files. These are YAML files, and you can put these files in Git, in your source control. By executing a CI/CD pipeline, you can configure Kubernetes every time on exactly the same way. If you take a look at portability of Kubernetes, Kubernetes runs everywhere. It runs on your local machine using the Docker for Windows, Docker for Mac, also with Minikube. It runs even on a Raspberry Pi in your private data center. And of course, the public clouds are offering Kubernetes also. The first one was Google. Azure came second with Azure Container Service. In the meantime, AWS has EKS. And now Azure has Azure Kubernetes Service. And that's what you should use on Azure. I'm an Azure MVP, so I know only about the Azure cloud. And that's the reason why I tell you about AKS. But the other clouds are offering the same offering, so they also have a managed Kubernetes cluster. And what does this mean? This means that we've seen the master and the worker nodes. The master is fully managed for you by the cloud provider. And that is really convenient because that is the hardest part to maintain. In this case, Microsoft is doing that for you. The worker nodes those are just IaaS, so virtual machines in the cloud. But Microsoft is applying updates to them, security updates, everything. The only thing that you have to do is reboot the machine on a time that is good enough for you. And you can automate that if you like. The good news in the Microsoft cloud is that you don't have to pay for the master nodes. You only pay for the worker nodes. So, if you want to use this, how does that look like? In Azure, you have something that's called a resource group. And in the resource group, you can create resources. In this case, a Kubernetes container cluster. You can specify the version that you like, the number of worker nodes, and the VM size that you would like. So, now it's time for the next step. This, anybody knows who which mountain this is? I don't hear it. It's the Stelvio mountain. It's in Italy. I've climbed it twice this year with my bike, and it has a really high learning curve. And the same goes for Kubernetes. If you want to use it, it has a really high learning curve. And that is because all the new terminology, it's overwhelming. And what I'm going to try in the rest of my session is to explain to you all this terminology so you have a really good quick start if you want to use Kubernetes from tomorrow on. So let's start. I mentioned the name pod already. A pod is the smallest deployable unit in Kubernetes. So you can't deploy an image, a Docker image, to Kubernetes. You have to deploy a pod. And a pod can contain one or more Docker containers. Usually one, and you can have two. But in my example, my web application with a front end and a back end, you don't want to run that in one pod, because a pod is also your scalable unit. So then I'm not able to scale my front end and back end separately. That's what I would like. So when do you need a second container in your pod? It's called a sidecar. A sidecar delivers some functionality to the main container. For example, a proxy, but could also be a little small application that reads a queue for you, for the main application. The pod has an IP address within the cluster, and it has a port range. So each container has a port assigned to it. You configure storage on the pod, and storage is for the rest of the session out of scope. But let's have a look at how you deploy such a thing to Kubernetes. As I've told you already, you are using declarative files. And at the left, you see this declarative file. It's the smallest declarative file that I could make to deploy an image. I'm going to deploy the leaderboard web API image. That's my backend with tag 455. There are all kinds of declarative files that you can deploy, and this kind is a deployment. And I want to run three containers. So if one of my containers is crashing, my application is still up. They call that replicas in Kubernetes. At the right, you can see what Kubernetes will deploy, the resources in Kubernetes. So the deployment itself, and at the bottom, you can see the three pods with the container in it. And because we deploy a deployment, we also get a replica set. He knows about the three pods. You can execute this YAML file with a command at the bottom of the screen. So kubectl apply minus f for file, and you give the file name. What you can see here at the right is those components are not connected to each other, but they do know each other. And that's another concept in Kubernetes. It's called a label. So you can, every resource in Kubernetes, you can give it a label. And in this case, the label of the pods is backend. And you can use a label selector on, in this case, for the replica selector. Between the deployment and the replica set, it's the same story. We will see labels later on again, because it is an important concept in Kubernetes. So let's have a look at a real cluster. I've provisioned the cluster with the commands that I showed you. And I've the deployment file right here. This is VStudio code, and I've applied the shortcut key so I can execute commands very quick so you don't have to see me typing. So let's first have a look. Oh, I don't send you. That's better. Yes. All right. So I executed this command, kubectl get notice. So this is VStudio code. And we can see the three nodes that I've provisioned here with the latest version. And 2 days ago, I started this cluster. We can also have a look at the pods that are running now on the cluster. And it says no resources found. It's because it's a new cluster, so we start from nothing. Let's deploy the file. As I already told you, minus F with an apply, and it's already created. Let's have a look at the pods now again. I'll make it a bit bigger. And we can see that there are running 5 pods now in this case. Every pod is deployed on a different node, as you can see. We have 3 nodes. The IP addresses of the nodes are showed there. I don't have anything to say about how Kubernetes is deploying or running my Docker images. He decides this. And that is also what I would like. I just want to tell him, run my application, and I don't want to think about how he does that. All right, this is the command line, but we also have, of course, the dashboard. So I will start the dashboard. The dashboard is actually running in the Kubernetes cluster as a pod. And we can create a tunnel through to this with a special command, and that is kubectl proxy. And now we can access it from our local machine. So this is the Kubernetes dashboard. You can see all the resources that you can deploy at the left. And I've selected the deployment here. So we can see that it has a label and it's running 5 pods. So that's good. Let's click on this deployment. And we can see that there is a replica set here. Oh, again, with a label, we can see which image it is running. Click this replica set. And now we can see the 5 pods that I'm running. In case your container crashes, it's the same functionality as like when I do a delete of this container. I can just delete this. Let's have a look at the pods again. As you can see, I will refresh this window again. It doesn't refresh automatically. And in the meantime, you can see at this time, because of this container is running 9 seconds now, we have declaratively configured Kubernetes to run 5 containers. So as soon as he sees that there are running 4 containers because one is crashed, he will start up a new container immediately. That's what I want. I don't want to think about this. So what we can also do, we can easily manually scale up. So let's make 7 replicas and apply this file again. If you refresh this. We can see 7 containers running. That's also an advantage of using actually Docker containers. They are so fast in running but also in startup time. So what I would like to show you is how my backend actually looks like, because you have not seen it yet. To do that, I need the name of one of the pods. So let's take this one. And put it in here. What I'm going to execute is a port forward. And it works the same as the dashboard what I showed you, but the dashboard has a special command. With the dashboard you execute kubectl proxy, but now we are executing a port forward, and we are forwarding it to port 9292. So let's execute this also. It is a web API project, so I have implemented Swagger on it, otherwise you won't see anything. It's a small API, it's a leaderboard application, and I'll show you some data, try it out. And we got here some information about the games that I played, Far Cry and FIFA, for example. It's just to give you a note about what data this API returns. So, let's get back to the slides. Great. All right, the rolling updates. I'll show you that. What we are going to see is I will apply a rolling update, and of course I don't want to have downtime. So how does that work? What I have added to my configuration is this piece here. It's a rolling update strategy. And every time when I execute this, he will see that there is a new image because I have applied a new tag to my image here, 5458. And this rolling update tells me, Kubernetes, you are allowed to add one new pod with a new image. And if that runs successfully for 5 seconds, then you are allowed to remove one of the old versions of the Docker image, of the old pod, actually. He does that all the time, and yeah, if we do this 7 times now, then our application is updated without any downtime and with a minimal amount of risk. So let's see how that looks like. I will this one. There are 7 now. I apply this configuration. Oh, I have to stop. This one. I apply this configuration. It's already applied. And if we take a look at the dashboard again, yeah, there was the old pod. That pod is disappeared now. You could see yeah, 2 containers need to be updated. You can see in the age here at the number of seconds how many containers are already updated. So in the meantime, almost all containers are updated because I'm too slow. And now they are all updated. So that's the way a rolling update takes place. So you move your Docker containers from environment to environment, but they have specific environment variables. They have, for example, a connection string to a different database, or you want the log level on a different level. With Docker images, you specify that with environment variables, and you can also specify environment variables on your deployment of Kubernetes. So here you see an example. Environment variables are there just in clear text, as you can see. This is the way you specify that. If you don't want to have a clear text variable, you can use secrets. Secrets is another concept in Kubernetes. At the right, you can see the declarative file. It is an opaque secret, and the rest of the information is decided by myself, so the connection string, and it is base64 encoded. So it is not that secret, it's just an encoding. It's very easy to decode this and see the connection string. It is meant so you don't see the value right away. At the left, in our deployment, you can see how we reference this secret. So we have no secrets in our source control this way. There are multiple kinds of secrets. At the bottom of the declarative file, I've specified the image pool secret. That's the secret that you use so Kubernetes can access your Docker registry, which is private. You can use any Docker registry that you like. If you use a public one, then Kubernetes can find the image right away. But if you use a private one, then it's also private Kubernetes, of course. So you need to specify the connection string in Kubernetes so Kubernetes can access that registry. And now you can find the Docker images. We even have to configure more on the deployment. We have to configure health checks. Well, we have to, it is not needed, but it is a good practice. You can specify two types of health checks, the liveness probe and the readiness probe. You configure them both on the same way. In the case of the liveness probe, that gives information about your application, if it's healthy or not. I've implemented it with AppMetrics, for example. You get an endpoint and it returns an HTTP status code of 200. If there's anything else than 200, it's not healthy. If you configure it in Kubernetes, and in this case, the failure threshold is 3, so if Kubernetes receives 3 times another value than 200, then Kubernetes will restart your Docker image, the pod, actually. The readiness probe looks the same, but is a different kind of health probe. Sometimes when your container starts, it needs some time to initialize, maybe 5 to 10 seconds, something like that. Maybe he needs to read a queue or a configuration file, could be anything. It takes time. And during that time, you won't be able to request traffic. That's where the readiness probe is for. So when your container is ready, then, only then, Kubernetes sends traffic to your pods. One more thing that we will configure, and it's also best practice. You should really do this in your deployment file, and that is you have to specify the minimal and the maximum amount of resources. You can specify that both on the CPU and on memory. If you have specified this, then you can also use the next level of deployment, and that is the horizontal pod autoscaler. I can't show you in this session because of time, but the horizontal pod autoscaler, I showed you how we manually autoscaled by increasing the number of replicas. That's nice, but it was more nice. It was even nicer if Kubernetes could do that for us, and that is possible with the horizontal pod autoscaler. If you want to use that, you have to specify this resource management, these requests and limits. So that's a lot of configuration on the pods and a lot of terminology already. And I've showed you also how I can access my web API. But I can only access it from my local machine and only one pod. I really want to access my application now from the internet. So how does that work? That was not very easy, if you think about it, to solve for Kubernetes, because in this sample we have several pods and every pod has an IP address. But it could be that this pod here crashes. And Kubernetes can deploy this pod on any node he likes. It will get a new IP address, even if it's on the same node. So how can we route traffic to my pods if the IP addresses are changing all the time? Well, there is a special resource in Kubernetes that makes sure that the IP address is fixed, and that is a service. So a service has a fixed IP address. And again, you see the labels here. So the service knows which pods belong to him based on the labels. There are different types of services. This is a cluster IP service, and that means that this service gets an IP address which is only known in the cluster. But then we don't have a public IP address yet. So we can also specify another type, load balancer. And now Kubernetes is talking with, if you host it on the cloud, with your public cloud provider. Your public cloud provider provides an IP address, and Kubernetes gets that. So if you take a look at my sample application, I have the 5 front-end pods and 3 back-end pods. And I want that my front-end pod is available for the internet. So I specify a load balancer type of service there. On the back-end, it's not needed that's accessible for the internet. So a cluster IP is enough for there. And now I have to configure my front-end pods with an environment variable so the front-end knows how to access the back-end. And you can do that not by specifying the IP address. Well, you could do, but you could also just use the name of the service. In this case, leaderboard API-service. You can see the configuration at the right. I've prepared a demo in my cluster. So let's have a look at that. And maybe you now think, hey, that's strange. When he started, he showed us that there were no resources in the cluster. And now he's telling us that there is the demo prepared with services. How is that possible? Well, that's because there are several namespaces. That's another concept in Kubernetes. Till now, I deployed everything in the default namespace. A namespace is an environment within Kubernetes. You can create namespaces as much as you like. You can create a namespace, for example, per branch that you're working on in Git. But you can also create a branch for each environment that you have: development, test, acceptance, production. And I have created a namespace for my demo. It's called service demo. So here are my pods again, 5 front-end pods and 3 back-end pods. Let's move on to the services now. The two services that I talked about, here is the back-end service with a cluster IP and the front-end service. And this one also has a public IP address because it's a load balancer. If I click it, then you can see my fancy front-end for the first time. And you can recognize maybe the data that I showed you when the pod was running on my local machine for the tunnel. So that's the way services works. So great, we can access our application from the internet. But I have 300 microservices. How should I do that? I have only, in the Azure cloud, you have only 20, 25 IP addresses that you can use by default. Or maybe you want to access your microservices based on a path or on a prefix of a domain name. If you want to use that, wrong side. Then you have to specify ingress. Ingress, it's the last topic that we will discuss during this session, and it's the most advanced topic that we will discuss. It's the next level for services, and to explain it, I have configured 3 applications with each 3 pods. So the front-end application, the ERP, and the CRM system. Because we need a fixed IP address within the cluster, I have a cluster IP service configured for each of them. Besides that, I need one load balancer service because I need a public IP address, so that is configured also on top. And I've deployed a special pod, the Kubernetes ingress controller. This is one of those extension points that I talked about. There are many ingress controllers. This is the most used one, the Nginx. Again, labels here to specify which belongs to each other. And now we configure ingress. You did that with a declarative file again, of course. And you specify which host name you want and the service that belongs to that host name. Based on that information, the ingress controller generates a configuration file for Nginx. So it knows if you access this hostname, I have to navigate to this IP address of the pod. And it does that round robin. So that's, in a nutshell, a lot of information for you. A lot of concepts in Kubernetes. That's the high learning curve that I talked about. And we have only talked about a few. But the good news is I've talked about the most important ones. Because if you have the knowledge that you have now, then you are able to start using Kubernetes actually right away. But you have to know that there are more concepts in Kubernetes. Let's talk about the ecosystem for a moment, because that's what makes Kubernetes so special and maybe why you could use Kubernetes to run your Docker images. The ecosystem is enormous. These are only a couple of examples. And I think I have to at least specify one, because if you're going to use Kubernetes, you will use Helm at least. Helm is the package manager of Kubernetes. As you have seen now, if you want to deploy an application to Kubernetes, you need a lot of declarative files. You need services, deployments, configuration, secrets, maybe ingress. So it's a whole package that you need to deploy. And that package is called a chart in Helm terms. For many applications, and the list here is not a full list, there are already Helm packages available, but you could also create a Helm package for your own application. And then we go to the end of the session, and I want to tell you, I want to give you a little preview of what is coming, and therefore I have to explain one more service which Azure offers, and that is Azure Container Instances. Azure Container Instances is actually serverless containers. So I don't specify any virtual machine. I just say, run my container, and it does so. Why is this so important? Well, here's this slide again. I told you we have the master and the worker nodes. The master is fully managed, but the worker nodes are managed IaaS. So I have to reboot them. Microsoft is applying updates, and maybe more important, they have a limited number of resources, the CPU, memory, hard disk space. Azure Container Instances is serverless, it's unlimited, so I don't have any limited amount of CPU or memory. So what has Microsoft created? They have created a virtual kubelet with a virtual node. What you are actually using is Kubernetes with Azure Container Instances for the worker nodes. And this is a major advantage to use Azure for Kubernetes, because the master is already managed, and now the worker nodes are managed also. This is not something for the far future. You can already use this now as a preview service in Azure. So this was the introduction on Kubernetes. And I think Kubernetes is the way you provision applications in the cloud. It's the new application platform. Hopefully you have a good overview of Kubernetes. Let's wrap this up. You can use Docker images instead of code to move your application from environment to environment. And you can use Kubernetes to have that on a scalable way without downtime and fault tolerant. Well, this was my presentation. I have some swag here with me, the stickers, as I told you. Together with a colleague, I've written in the previous magazine that we gave out as a company an article about Kubernetes. I have only two with me, but you can also download it in the link provided here. All my demos are on this GitHub URL, so if you like it, you can try it out yourself. And if you have any question, please come to me. I'm also available during the whole conference. Thank you.
Do you want to take some questions? We have time for 1 minute.
Fine.
We have 1 minute. Do you have any questions? Okay, I see one.
Hi. Real quick, you mentioned that on Azure you only pay for the worker nodes. I was wondering, do you have to pay for like the extra IP addresses or like the horizontal pod autoscaler, or is that within the package?
The horizontal pod autoscaler is something in Kubernetes. And he will deploy multiple pods, and it's all in the cluster, so that's just for the workers. But if you indeed are using an IP address or other resources in Azure, you have to pay for it. Yeah.
Great. Let's get some coffee and see you at 12:30.